Hello viewers, welcome to Newsweek South Asia, a program that talks about breeding of terrorism and its impact on South Asian nations. Let's begin with the headlines first. India holds NSA level meeting on Afghanistan crisis. ISIS-led violence dents Taliban's claim of safer Afghanistan. And Pakistan surrenders to terror group, agrees to 1 month ceasefire with Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan. Let's begin the show with India's efforts to bring regional peace by discussing developments in Afghanistan. Delhi Regional Security Dialogue in Afghanistan, which was attended by security officials of 8 countries, including India, Iran and Russia, called for closer coordination and collective efforts to tackle threats such as terrorism from Afghanistan and to address a looming humanitarian crisis. We have a detailed report.
Afghanistan is passing through a difficult time. Only good leadership, compassionate attitude and international support to the Afghan people would bring an end to the crisis. Many peace-loving countries are making efforts to prevent a catastrophic situation for the Afghan people. India is one among these countries which support all peace initiatives in Afghanistan. India recently hosted the third edition of the Delhi Regional Security Dialogue on Afghanistan 2 months after the Taliban took control of Kabul. The NSA meet, chaired by India's National Security Advisor Ajit Doval, addressed issues ranging from cross-border terror threat, presence of terror groups, political instability and spread of extremism from Afghanistan. The message from the 8 participating countries was clear that the instability in Afghanistan is a major concern. A consensus statement titled the Delhi Declaration was released, which emphasized maintaining the territorial integrity of Afghanistan and was against interference from outside powers, a clear message to Pakistan.
We are meeting today to discuss matters relating to Afghanistan. We all have been keenly watching the developments in that country. These have important implications, not only for the people of Afghanistan, but also for its neighbors and the region. This is the time for close consultations amongst us, greater cooperation and interaction and coordination among the regional countries.
А также будет способствовать скорейшему установлению долгосрочного мира в этой стране. Многосторонние встречи секретарей Советов Безопасности по афганской проблематике являются важным форматом, позволяющим на самом высоком уровне обсудить весь комплекс проблем, связанных с развитием ситуации в Афганистане, а также выработать практические меры по противодействию вызовам и угрозам, исходящим с афганской территории.
The high-level dialogue was not attended by 2 neighboring countries of Afghanistan, Pakistan and China. It is not difficult to understand the message that both these countries send out by declining to attend the meet. Both China and Pakistan have extended a hand to the Taliban after they have taken over Afghanistan. Islamabad's decision in particular to not attend the crucial talks was not surprising, as it has not attended the previous meetings of this format. The Taliban takeover has been perceived as a positive development by policy and military circles in Islamabad. Moreover, the South Asian country has always lent a hand to the Taliban by providing safe havens to Taliban fighters during the US-led operation. This is the reason that when India was hosting a high-level meet on Afghanistan situation, Pakistani authorities were welcoming a delegation led by Taliban's acting foreign minister in Islamabad.
हमने चीन को भी आमंत्रण जारी किया था. उन्होंने जैसे आपने कहा कुछ कारणवश शेड्यूलिंग वो कह रहे थे कि नहीं आ पाए. अब बाकी वो कहां और जाते हैं और क्या करते हैं इस पे मैं टिप्पणी नहीं करना चाहूंगा. आपने कहा पाकिस्तान में जो हो रहा है, देखिए पाकिस्तान को भी इनविटेशन दिया गया था, आमंत्रण जारी किया गया था, वो नहीं आए. इसमें मैं यही कहूंगा कि ऐसी इंपॉर्टेंट मीटिंग में नहीं आए तो उनका इससे पता चल सकता है कि उनका किस तरह का रवैया है अफगानिस्तान के मुद्दे पर।
India has sent out a strong message that the ideal solution to the situation is through consensus in Afghanistan. It also made it clear that the Afghan humanitarian crisis should be the region's immediate priority and political differences can be kept aside to help. By declining the invitation, Beijing and Islamabad have made it clear that they do not intend to assist India in its Afghan engagement. Perhaps peace in Afghanistan is something they do not desire.
Three months after the Taliban seized power in Afghanistan, violence, death and fear continue to stalk the country. US-led NATO troops might have departed, but the new Islamist rulers in Kabul are threatened by an insurgency launched by Islamic State Khorasan province, an ISIS-inspired jihadi movement that has deep ideological differences with the Taliban. A report.
The Taliban fighters in these military vehicles are carrying out a demonstration of power with the parade. They are showing the weapons that fell into their hands after the withdrawal of the US Army. Recently, a video released by the Taliban showed hundreds of military forces graduating from a training center in Kandahar province. But these visuals raise an important question that needs to be answered by the new rulers of Afghanistan. Does this show off of power have any meaning when another terrorist group, Islamic State, is continuously carrying out deadly attacks in the country? In recent weeks, Shiite mosques have been the target of attacks that have killed dozens by a group which has emerged as the biggest threat to the Taliban control of Afghanistan. Just a few days ago, a suicide attack at a military hospital in Kabul killed at least 25 people and injured many others. Two heavy explosions hit the entrance of the Sardar Muhammad Daud Hospital and were followed with an assault by a group of Islamic State gunmen.
قدرتمند کشورهای دارای اقتصاد بالا اگر افغانستان را کمک نکنه کشورهایی که داد از حقوق بشر میزنه داد از عدالت میزنه داد از مساوات برابری میزنه اگر در این شرایط افغانستان را تنها بگذاره کمک نکنه به داد مردم مظلوم افغانستان نرسه وضعیت در آینده بحرانی است.
The blasts added to a growing list of attacks and killings by Islamic State since the Taliban completed their victory over the previous government in August. ISIS terrorists in Afghanistan first came to global attention when it carried out a massive suicide bombing attack at one of the gates near Kabul airport, killing a large number of people. Since then, the group has carried out a string of attacks in different parts of the country. The violence has fueled fears that Afghanistan could collapse into anarchy and even return to a new phase of civil war. The Islamic State group's attacks, coupled with a spiraling economic crisis, have caused mounting concern over the future stability of the country.
و خصوصا در کشور ما قدرت خواهد گرفت و جنگ‌های داخلی و مثل سابق ما انتحاری که طالب میکرد امور از این بعد دایش انجام میده از این بعد گروه های دیگری خود اینجا پیدا شد ظهور خواهد کرد که برای منفعت مملکت ما نخواهد
Islamic State has viewed the Taliban as a strategic rival. The militants of this terror outfit consider the Taliban as filthy nationalists who have betrayed the greater Islamic cause. They see the Taliban as just another kind of political outfit cutting deals with the Americans that is ideologically not pure as per ISIS. The brutal jihadi group's fight against the Taliban is entering a new phase, and analysts believe that in the coming days, this rivalry will take more violent form.
Let's move to Pakistan, where the government bows down to extremist outfits, be it Jamaat-ud-Dawa, Tehreek-e-Labbaik Pakistan or Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan. With the changing political scenario in neighbouring Afghanistan, Islamabad has now agreed to complete a ceasefire with local Taliban, a banned extremist group having close links with the Al-Qaeda terror outfit. This has failed Pakistan for its claim to be fighting terrorism on its soil. We have a detailed report.
A flashback to 16 December 2014. Six gunmen affiliated with the Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan conducted a terrorist attack on the Army Public School in Peshawar city of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa province. It was one of the world's deadliest school massacres. The attack was the result of a joint military offensive conducted by the Pakistan Armed Forces in June 2014 in North Waziristan. The military operation called Operation Zard-e-Asp was launched in the wake of 8 June attack on Jinnah International Airport in Karachi, for which Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan claimed responsibility. The Taliban in Pakistan has close links with Al-Qaeda, Haqqani Network and other banned terror outfits, which are not only responsible for violence in the country, but other parts of the world. Islamabad promised the world to fight against these terror groups, but has now agreed to have a ceasefire with the Taliban.
ایک معاہدے کے تحت حکومت پاکستان اور طریقے طالبان پاکستان مکمل سیز فائر کے اوپر آمادہ ہو چکے ہیں جو مذاکرات طریقے طالبان پاکستان سے ہو رہے ہیں وہ پاکستان کے آئین اور قانون کے تحت ہوں گے ظاہر ہے کوئی بھی حکومت پاکستان کے آئین اور قانون سے باہر مذاکرات کر ہی نہیں سکتی
Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan has a separate movement from the Afghan Taliban and has fought for years to overthrow the government in Islamabad and rule the nation with their own brand of Islamic Sharia law. There have been numerous failed attempts to reach peace agreements in the past. The latest talks were opened following the victory of the Afghan Taliban in August, and the two sides have been meeting across the border in Afghanistan with the aid of Afghan Taliban leaders.
مذاکرات کی پیش رفت کو سامنے رکھتے ہوئے سیز فائر یعنی فائر بندی میں توسیع ہوتی جائے گی ان مذاکرات میں افغانستان کی اتھارٹیز یعنی جو عبوری حکومت ہے انہوں نے سہولت کار کا کردار ادا کیا ہے اور یقینی طور کے اوپر یہ بات بہت خوش آئند ہے کہ پاکستان کے یہ علاقے ایک طویل عرصے کے بعد مکمل امن کی طرف بڑھ رہے ہیں
The Pakistan Taliban was formed by armed rebels in 2007 and since then thousands of people have been killed in dozens of attacks claimed by the group in the past 14 years. About a million people were displaced when the Pakistan Army launched operations in the northwest in 2013 to clear out TTP fighters. After years of conflict, the Taliban in Pakistan is estimated to control some 4,000 to 5,000 fighters, many based across the border in Afghanistan. Experts believe the truce between the Pakistan government and TTP is difficult to sustain.
It has been extremely difficult for the Pakistani establishment to manage the Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan, which has been directly confronting the state. They have also been attacking various places and bombs and all that. This is terrorism has been one of their main hallmarks. So this has been a very major challenge. And so this is the reason and they have agreed to some kind of a ceasefire. It remains to be seen as to exactly how they are going to work out together because they are not on the same page. The problem with Pakistan has been that it has been fomenting terrorism and trouble across the border with India. And it has been not able to, you know, manage this particular entity normally it has tried to send all the terrorists here and there into India and created a big mischief, but TTP is giving them a run.
Since the Taliban takeover in Kabul, Pakistan believes it as its own victory. It is busy welcoming the Taliban leaders and helping them to get global recognition. Unfortunately, the Taliban in its own hinterland is repressible. The month-long ceasefire with the TTP seems to be another gimmick to befool the international community.
Let's move to India's Jammu and Kashmir, which remains a victim of Pakistan-sponsored terrorism. The terror factories located in Pakistan and along the line of control in Pakistan-occupied Kashmir are continuing to push in terrorists into Jammu and Kashmir. The purpose is to unleash violence in the Union Territory at the behest of the Pakistan Army and the spy agency ISI. And for that, this time too, they continued their strategy of killing the innocent civilians to create unrest in Kashmir Valley. A report.
Kashmir bleeds again. Pakistani terrorists continue bloodshed in the valley. In the third attack by terrorists in only 4 days, two persons were injured in Jammu and Kashmir this week after terrorists launched a grenade attack in Srinagar's old city Eidgah. One of the two persons was a policeman. Earlier, Ibrahim Khan, an employee at a shop owned by a Kashmiri Pandit, was the latest victim in a series of targeted killings when terrorists opened fire at the stop in Srinagar. A day prior to Ibrahim's killing, a 29-year-old policeman identified as Tawseef Ahmed was also shot dead by terrorists in the city. The situation is tense in Jammu and Kashmir since the spate of civilian killings last month, wherein as many as 14 people, mostly migrant workers and members of the minority community, were killed by terrorists. And earlier, while their targets were restricted to the religious minorities and migrant laborers from other states of India, the recent attacks on Kashmiri Muslims have exposed their real diabolic agenda. Experts believe the terrorists are neither fighting for Kashmir nor Islam. They just want to unleash unrest in India.
When Pakistan plays Muslim card that the Kashmiri Muslims are, they belong to their religion, how is it that Muslim police constable is getting killed? That means Pakistan has no love lost for Muslim Kashmiris. It only believes in creating terror. If Muslim was the brotherhood card, then why Muslim police constable is getting killed?
Amid a spike in brutal killings of civilians, terror attacks and infiltration bids by Pakistani terrorists, the Indian security forces have launched a major crackdown on overground workers associated with several terror groups as part of a determined effort to dismantle the entire terror ecosystem in the valley. This includes identifying the terror sympathizers who radicalized youths in schools, civilian neighborhoods, and provide logistical support to terrorists. Around 900 overground workers associated with Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jaish-e-Muhammad, Hizbul Mujahideen, Al-Badr, and similar other outfits and their affiliates, including the Resistance Front and the People Against Fascist Forces, were apprehended in joint operations by Indian security forces. Meanwhile, at least 19 terrorists were eliminated in counter-terrorism operations.
One casualty on our side, 20 casualties of terrorists. But the most important thing I would like to mention is that through in source, let's identify the terror structure. Who are the people who are part of terror structure? OGWs, sleeper cells, people who provide shelter, people who provide ammunition, food, shelter at night, allow terrorists to get away by acting as a kavach or a shield in front of armed forces, army. This terror structure has to be destroyed totally and ruthlessly. Then only things will improve.
In February, India and Pakistan have mutually agreed to abide by the 2003 ceasefire agreement after assurance from Islamabad that it will act against terror groups originating from its land. However, Pakistan does not seem to have stopped its nefarious activities under pressure from terrorist organizations and jihadi elements. Despite being on the Financial Action Task Force grey list, Islamabad has been constantly supporting anti-India elements, which led to increasing civilian casualties in the valley. Amidst the ongoing turmoil in Pakistan by Tehreek-e-Labbaik Pakistan and Tehreek-e-Taliban, it has become imperative for Pakistan to divert attention from its internal issues towards creating tensions in Kashmir. And for that, a plan to push more and more terrorists in Kashmir before the heavy snowfall is being hatched by them. It was also revealed that Pakistan's inter-service intelligence has been providing all logistic support to these outfits and trying to infiltrate them as soon as possible. But to their much disappointment, all such plans are getting thwarted at the hands of Indian security forces, who are marching well ahead on their mission of making the valley terrorism-free.
And with that, we come to the end of this edition of Newsweek South Asia. We will be back next week with more news, views and analysis from the subcontinent. Meanwhile, do keep writing to us at nwsa@nin.com. This is Shreya Savitre signing off on the behalf of entire production team of Newsweek South Asia. Goodbye and take care.